Praise God. Bwana asifiwe. Bwana asifiwe tena. My name is Susan Mbiti, and I'm here to do three things. The first one is to smile at you so that you may smile back at me. Yes, I need you all to be smiling at me until I'm done. The second thing I'm here to do is kuiba kawibo. To chase away the butterflies. It's hot up here. And the third thing I'm here to do is to share three things I've learned with you, and then I'll be out. So let us rise up on our feet. I've done the first one. I'm smiling, so smile back. I'd request the person in the sound room to please project a song for the... I really love this song because it says that we are worshiping God just because of who he is, just because of his nature, not because of what he has given us, not because of what he... Amen. Not because of what he has done, what he is doing, or what he will do, but because of who he is. So the lyrics are there. Just, yeah.
Because of who you are, I give you glory. Because of who you are, I give you praise. Because of who you are, I will lift my voice and say, Lord, I worship you. Because of who you are, Lord, I worship, Lord, I worship you. Because of who you are, because of who you are, I give you glory.
worship you.
We worship because of who you are.
Come on, just worship God. Our King Jesus, we are before your throne of grace, my God, to worship you, O God, because of who you are, because of your name, because you are the same yesterday, today, and forever, and you change not. Our circumstances, our situations may change, but you remain the same. Our ideas, our knowledge may change time to time, but you remain the same. And so we worship you because of who you are this morning, and because you are the only constant in our life. You are the only thing that is constant in our life, and we are humbled to have you as our King, as our Lord, as our Father, and as the lover of our souls. Jehovah God, as we sit to listen from you, I pray that you will speak to each and every one of us in a language that we can all understand. May you speak into our hearts, O God, and may all hearts and all ears be open to you, O God. I pray, King of all glory, that your spirit will speak through me, O God, because I'm just but a vessel, O God. So I yield to your spirit and I yield to your guidance, O God, and I thank you for the realization that our sufficiency, my sufficiency, comes from you. We love you and we adore you, for it is in the mighty name of Jesus we ask. Let's give God a hand. You can have your seats. Praise God. Ooh, yeah. The Gideonites have done an amazing job today. Cindy, let us clap. Let's give them a mighty hand clap. Again, my name is Susan Mbiti, and it's such an honor and a privilege to stand before you today. It's always an honor. I'd like to thank God first for allowing me and for choosing me to be his servant today. I'd like to thank Bishop and Mom Alice and the church leadership for allowing me to stand here. It's an honor. It's a privilege. I'm honored. I'd like to thank my pastor, Pastor Omedo, and our patron, Jim Sovetti, and the entire Gideonites leadership for allowing me to be here today. Who else? I'd like to thank the Gideonites. Gideonites in the house. Wow. Yes. And I'd like to thank my mom. I don't know if she's in the house. Mom. Yes, that's my mom. And my shosho is in the building. Yes, that's my shosho. Yes, now we can go into the word, right? So today I want to talk about three things that I have learned the past, I think in the past this 1 week. And in summary, I want us to talk about the power of understanding. The power of understanding. And we'll do three things. We will do the power of understanding the element of identity, the power of understanding the element of revelation, and the power of understanding the element of faith. Praise God. Let's turn to the book of Luke 22, verse 40, in the Message version, please. Don't forget to smile at me. That's your job until the service is over. A good smile is good medicine. It makes you pretty. Yes. This is the story of Jesus at the Garden of Gethsemane. Tuko point number one tayari, the element of identity, the power of understanding the element of identity. Luke 22, verse 40 to 53. When they arrived at the place, he said, "Pray that you do not give in to temptation." He pulled away from them about a stone's throw, knelt down, and prayed. Father, remove this cup from me, but please, not what I want, but what you want. At once an angel from heaven was at his side, strengthening him. He prayed on all harder. Sweat ran from him like drops of blood poured off his face. He got up from prayer, went back to the disciples, and found them asleep, dragged by grief. 46. He said, "What business do you have sleeping? Get up, pray, so that you won't give in to temptation." 47. No sooner were the words out of his mouth than a crowd showed up. Judas, the one from the 12 in the lead, he came right up to him to kiss him. My emphasis is Jesus praying and asking God to take the cup away from him. Let us look at Mark 14:36 also in the Message version. Yes. Papa, Father, you can't you, get me out of this. Take this cup away from me, but please, not what I want, what do you want? I think I would like us to read all this together. So one, two, go. Papa, Father, you can't you, get me out of this. Take this cup away from me, but please, not what I want, but what you want. Bless the name of the Lord. It gives me comfort, and it amazes me that even he who was God in man got to a place in his life where he questioned, or rather he asked his father, or he told God to take away whatever it is that he was going through. It gives me peace to know that I'm not siko pabaya, or rather I'm very normal in asking God, can you get me out of this? God, this is too hard. Can you pull me out of this? Because here we see that the Son of God, who was God himself, got to a place in his life where he asked, Papa, you can't you? You see, he emphasizes, you see, in our English classes, we did something called question tags. Hello? Yeah, question tags. So ukiuliza mtu, utakuja, sindio? It's like you're answering for them. Unamwambia, utakuja, sindio? You're already giving them the answer. So when Jesus is at the Garden of Gethsemane, and that is when he realizes this is actually happening. So he goes and he's there, he's grieving, and he's crying to his father and asking him, Papa, you can't you? Papa, you can, sindio? Get me out of this. And our first point is understanding the element of identity. At the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus was going through a mental and spiritual battle at the same time. And understanding this element of identity, one thing that I came to realize why it was so intense was because destiny came into contact with humanity. This was his destiny, but he was still human. This was God's plan for him, but he was still human. Before I go there, let's look at Matthew 26, verse 41, also in the Message. Matthew 26, 41. Matthew 26:41 says, "Stay alert, be in prayer, so that you don't wander into temptation without even knowing you are in danger." This is what I want. There is a part of you that is eager, ready for anything in God. Amen? There is a part of you that is eager, ready for anything in God. But there's another part that's as lazy as an old dog sleeping by the fire. Is that true? There's a part of you. See, upon tunafika tunasema that the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. And Jesus, you see, one amazing thing that really gives me joy is to know that we serve a king who understands our struggle. We serve a king who went before us and won the battle already. We serve a king that went and he came at a point where he was torn between his divinity and his humanity, between his destiny and his humanity and his flesh. And at that time, it was such an intense spiritual battle that ni kama sweat glands na capillaries zilichanganikiwa. Hazijui ni gani itatoa sweat, ni gani itatoa blood. It was so intense. And why I'm saying that we need to understand identity is, let us look at the life of Jesus before he gets to the Garden of Gethsemane, before he even lands. The prophets kept saying, a king is coming. And the Israelites waited for a king to come in majesty. But then he came as a servant. Praise God. So he, you see, there is who you are and there is what you are. Praise God. And Jesus was a king, the king of all kings, the Lord of all lords. And I want us to look briefly at who he was and what he was. You see, he's a king, but he came as a servant. This name king came from who he was. But what does he do? He serves. He comes in the most humble way ever. From Mary to being born in a manger, we do not expect a king to come that way. So we can see that who he is and what he was doing were two different things. Praise God. So if we were to look at the identity of Jesus according to how most of us understand, you see, when the question of who you are comes in, then the question of what you deserve follows. Praise God. You see, I'm my father's daughter. Okay, probably that is open for debate where I'm heading. I am entitled to his inheritance, right? Ukweli. Yes. It's not just the male... the male sons. So when I realize that I am my father's daughter, that is who I am, then automatically I am entitled to what he owns. Praise God. So Jesus as a king, the name king comes from who he is. But then what does he do? Does he sit in a big chair? He's just ordering people around, getting served? No, he's serving. So are you realizing how who he is contradicts what he's doing? You see, I want to present to us this morning that the enemy sometimes is not concerned about who you are. You can be God's son all you want. You can be a royal priesthood, a holy nation all you want. You can be a God all you want, because Psalms 82 verse 6 tells us that, "Have I not said that ye are gods? And all of you are children of the Most High." You can be all you want, but the enemy is not concerned about who you are. He's more concerned about what you do, about who you are. Praise God. Because all along, Jesus was, he grew up, he's young, he's playing with the kids, but until he's 30 and he's led into the wilderness to pray and fast, that is when his ministry was being birthed. And the enemy had no business with him all through until he was 30. Praise God. So why is it that he shows up after the 40 days are over? It's because Jesus realizes that, fine. In fact, the enemy knew that he was the Son of God the day he was born. Praise God. So he never touched him. He never even akuapia mbele yake. Praise God. So he shows up when he's 30. Immediately his ministry is being born, because who you are, you can be spirit-filled, demon-chasing, halfway up to heaven, all you want. But the devil is not concerned about that. He's concerned about what you do, about who you are. Because Jesus was the Son of God all the way till he was 30. But at 30, his ministry had to begin. So he realized what he needs to do about who he was. He was the Son of God, the Messiah, the one who was to redeem us. And that is where the journey began. Praise God. And so sometimes, you see, he is there and he's asking, "Father, Papa, you can, can't you?" Because it was so hard. It is normally such a challenge for destiny and humanity to come into contact. Because the flesh will never, ever, ever agree with what the Spirit of God wants. They are antagonistic. Praise God. So we need to understand this element of identity, that it doesn't matter who you are. What matters is what you're doing about who you are. As a child of God, you can be a child of God. We can lead praise here, we can preach, we can pray all we want. But as long as we do not do whatever is expected of us about who we are, then we will never really understand why we are who we are. Praise God. We need to understand, why is it that we were given power, authority, and dominion? Why is it that we are called a royal nation, a holy priesthood? Why is it that we are called gods? Because until we understand that, then we will never, you see, the main reason as to why we were created is to let the kingdom of God come. We are representatives of the kingdom of God on earth. Praise God. And so when Jesus is here at the Garden of Gethsemane and he's asking God, get me out of this, can't you? And then he goes on to say, but not what I want, but what you want. Praise God. Let us turn to John 14, verse 13 to 14. John 14, 13 in the message. First NIV. NIV. John 14, 13. And I will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Son may bring glory to the Father. Praise God. Message. From now on, whatever you request, praise God, whatever you request along the lines of who I am and what I am doing, I will do it. That's how the Father will be seen for who he is in the Son. I mean it. Bless the name of the Lord. You see, Jesus, atangeliaji. It says that whatever you ask, but there's a condition, in line with who I am and what I am doing. God was in the business of redeeming an entire human race. God was in the business of removing sin from us. God was in the business of giving us the right to sonship. And so no matter how much Jesus wanted, or rather even God, angeuliza, angeuliza, Papa, please take this away from me. God is able to answer any prayer. Sindio, amesema, ask anything and I will do it if you ask it in my name. But I love how the message rendition puts it. If you ask whatever, ask whatever, but in the lines of who I am and what I am doing. So what am I saying to us? You know, sometimes we go through things as children of God and you're asking yourself, I've been serving, I'm faithful in giving, I'm doing this, I'm doing that, I'm doing that. Why am I going through this? Do I really deserve this as a son of God? Jesus as king, did he deserve to die how he did? Did Peter deserve, or Paul, all those apostles of Jesus deserve to die how they died? No, you see, there's a point of maturity that as children of God we need to reach to toyo swalia, what do we deserve? Because God will allow you to go through some things and you will pray and ask him to get you out of it, but sometimes he won't, because there is something he's doing. You see, he asks, if you ask for anything in my name, I will do it, as long as it is in the line of who I am and what I am doing. Praise God. As long as it is in the line of who I am and what I am doing. And Dad, I remember some few Sundays ago, alikuwa anasema, wengine wetu kama hatungevutwa kazi, we wouldn't own the companies we own right now. Praise God. Wengine wetu kama God would have never pulled you out of that relationship, you wouldn't be where you are right now. Some of us, if God hadn't allowed us to understand pain, what pain is, we wouldn't know that he's our healer. If you never went through discouragement, you wouldn't understand that the joy of the Lord is your strength. Praise God. You see, as the Israelites were about to conquer the wall of Jericho, God instructs them to walk around 7 times. Wouldn't he have done it once? They would have, in fact, they would have just spoken to the wall and it would have fallen. Praise God. But God is in the business of not only giving you what you want, but there's an addition to it. There's a journey. And during Jericho, it was a walk of faith. He would eventually bring down that wall for them. But at the same time, he would have built their faith in him. Praise God. At the same time, he would have still brought the wall down in a day. But God is in the business of making us more like him every single day. So sometimes he can't give us what we want, just voila. Ati God this, there. God here, here. You know, he has to, you see, Enoch walked with God until he was no more. You see, I every time I read that passage, it reminds, like, I try picturing, he walked with God until he was no more. He walked with God, and every day he walked with God, Enoch decreased as God increased. He walked the more, Enoch decreased and God increased. He walked the more with God, and Enoch kept decreasing as God increased. And I tend to believe alichukuliwa kwa sababu alitembea akatembea akatembea na Mungu mpaka akafanana karibu na Mungu. So, oh, he had to be taken away. He had no business here. He had no business here because he walked with God until he was no more. It means two things. Until he was no, yani Enoch hakuwa, sasa ni Mungu. You see the book of 2 Corinthians, you see the glory of God, as we behold it as in a mirror, so do we become. You see, the more you behold of God, the more you become of God. The more you fellowship with God, the more you become of God. The more you understand God, the more you become more like him. Because sometimes we need to fix our eyes on the bigger picture. Because he'll still bring your wall down. He will still bring Jericho down. He will still bring that healing that you're asking for. He'll still bring the provision that you're desperately cleaving on prayer for. But let's not be too quick to have it and miss the point. Praise God. Because the point is becoming more like his son. You see, I've gotten to a place where, and I'm asking God, if it takes pain to become more like you, bring it on. If it takes perseverance, if it takes tears to become more like you, bring it on. Praise God. So that is the element of identity. Forget what you deserve. Forget, because Jesus didn't deserve it. Forget what you deserve and fix your eyes on the bigger picture. Fix your eyes not on who you are, but on doing what you're supposed to be doing about who you are. Praise God. Ha, tunaendelea vizuri. Number two, the element of revelation. Luke 23, verse 39 to 43 in the message. Luke 23, verse 39 to 43. Hey, kuna joto hapa, we. One of the criminals hanging alongside cast him, "Some Messiah you are, save yourself, save us." 40. But the other one made him shut up. "Have you no fear of God? You're getting the same as him. We deserve this, but not him. He did nothing to deserve this." Hey, what do I deserve? Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you enter your kingdom." 43. And he said, "Don't worry." Don't? "I will. Today you will join me in paradise." You see, Jesus is akwapa kwa cross. The king, the Messiah, who was sinless, and he's hanging between two fugitives. Hata ungepita hapo na gari jamani na huko unajua ni nini inafanyika, you wouldn't even identify that the Son of God, who was the righteousness of God, was hanging there. Wote ungewaangalia, they were in the same situation. Praise God. But you see, the first thief, and they all died, right? But the first thief died out of the will of God. The second thief died in the will of God. And Jesus died for the will of God. Same situation, different reasons. They're all hanging on the cross. They're all wame aibishwa, wame temewa mate, all those people. But one thief dies out of the will of God, the other man dies in the will of God, and the other one dies for the will of God. You see, the difference between these two thieves, the one that died out of the will of God and the one that died in the will of God, was that the one who died out of the will of God gave weight to circumstance. This one that died in the will of God received revelation. That's the only difference. One of them gave weight to circumstance, the other one gave weight to revelation. And we ask, yani watu wenye hawajui Mungu, hawajaokoka, nini, all those things. They have this and I don't. I'm a child of God and I'm having financial issues. And people who don't even know God, they're also having financial issues. Why are we on the same level and I'm a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people? Each and every one of us needs, you see, revelation. I think nilifanya research kidogo, mtanipigia makofi nikimaliza kusoma hapa. Revelation in the Greek apparently inaitwa apocalypsis. Apocalypsis, and it is a particular spiritual manifestation of the will of Christ, which was previously unknown to this extent because it was either veiled or covered. Praise God. It's a particular spiritual manifestation of Christ and his will, previously unknown to the extent because it was veiled and it was covered. Praise God. Revelation is something very important because as long as we are here, we remain foreigners. And so afflictions, disappointment, pain will remain constant until we are out of here. Because this is not our home. So we can't expect this to feel like home. You see, Corinthians tells us that as long as we are at home in the body, we are apart from God. But as long as we are out of home from the body, we are home with God. Praise God. You see, Abraham, Jesus comes, and God comes, and anamwambia team, we, Sarah atapata mtoto, by the way. And then Sarah laughs, anacheka, lakini kichekocha, and Abraham laughs too. But Abraham's laughter was different from Sarah's. Sarah's was, I'm 90, y'all. I'm 40 past menopause. That's funny, but oh well. Yeah. But then Abraham alicheka hadi miguzi kaingia nini kichwa ikaingia katikati ya miguu, like he laughed. But then it was a laughter. Me and my friends here call it holy laughter. It's a laughter of revelation. He understood that he means business. He understood that he means business. And the Bible records that after he received it, inasemanga, and Abraham gave glory to God. Praise God. You see, glory means weight. Glory means weight. So he gave glory to God. And see how God treats him afterwards. Akaenda, akaenda, akagundua Sodom na Gomorrah kuna mambo yanafanyika huko, akakasirika, and he wants to destroy them. But look what he does. He comes to Abraham na namwambia, yo, naenda kuachoma huko, by the way, nimejam. Is it that he was asking for permission? Alikuwa namwambia mbona? Alikuwa tu namwambia, just for the sake, Abraham, I'm going to Sodom and Gomorrah, and this is what I'm about to do. You see, once you give glory to God, once you give weight to God, the word of God tells us that I no longer call you servants, but I call you, because a servant is not aware of what his master is up to, but a friend knows. So, You see, I know all of us have very close friends, and sometimes you don't tell them for advice. Unamwambianga tu, aya Nancy, by then naenda tao leo, sawa. You're not telling her to do anything, just for her to know what you're doing, because that's what friends do, amen? And you see, after Abraham gave weight to God, after Abraham gave glory to God, this is how God treated him. He began revealing even the deep things of God. The things that the flesh could not perceive, he began revealing to him. And that is why I'm calling it the element of revelation. Tunaweza kwa sisi wote broke. But excuse me, I'm not broke because of the reason why you're broke. I'm sorry, maybe you're broke because you never worked. But I'm broke because Jehovah Jireh wants to teach me what supplier God means. Praise God. So once you, there are so many things you can give weight to in your life. You can give weight to fear. You can give weight to intimidation. You can give weight, uneza, but it's your choice. You know, sometimes I feel like, aki Mungu angetupea free will. Kwa sababu sa zingine ndio utuangusha. The fact that it's in your hand to choose. Sometimes I just feel, oh, Jesus, hold me. Like, because sometimes, if we allowed God to make the decisions for us, some of us wouldn't be where we are right now. Praise God. And it's all up here. The battle begins here. You see, Jesus, tukirudi point one, at the Garden of Gethsemane, he won the battle at the garden, not at Calvary. At Gethsemane ndo aliishinda hiyo vita. Praise God. You see, it all begins, if you win the battle here, you've won it. Praise God. Because it's Gideon Sunday, just allow me. Tulienda, alini call, then tukaenda, and then he told me to go to his place, or she told me, and then sitasema vitu zingine jubisha kwa hapa. Excuse me, you didn't lose the battle when you slept with that man. You lost the battle when you answered that call in the first place. If you win it, yani ukiwa kwa nyumba yako hivi ulikuwa mshindi. Ulikuwa hivi umesimama imara wewe ni mshindi. But the minute you answered that call and you responded, the devil will always call you. Do you know that? Because he's a devourer, anatafuta hivi, ana seek. He just can't rest. So he'll always call. But will you respond? Because that's where you win the battle, in your secret place of prayer. You see, Psalms 91 tells us that he who abides in the secret place of the Most High, he who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. He shall say to me, you are my refuge, my strength, my God in whom I trust. He who dwells. A dwelling place is not a place where until you go and afu unatoka unaenda. I think I've given this illustration before here. You see, at home, when someone is making something, probably ama niende kwa Nancy. Nancy anajua vile napenda pancakes. And I love them with lemon, grated lemon and stuff. Yeah, I'm a child of the Most High. Hallelujah. Yeah. And you see, as Anna prepare, see, she has me in mind. So if she doesn't put lemon before, izo siku zingine, si ataeka leo. Why? Because I'm coming. Or rather, my mom, kuna vitu, I hate hoho. Iyo kitu ni kali. So when I'm home, she tries and avoid not make it. But when I'm not around, kwa sababu ni yeye peke yake, see, she can make it. Now you see, a place where there's home, you see, he says that he prepares a table for you in the presence of your enemies. Praise God. Ku prepare sika ku make. Ku prepare ni. You know, like he's preparing with you in mind. So he seasons with exactly the spices that you need. Not the spices that Sue needs. Not the spices that Nancy needs. Not the spices that your neighbor needs. The spices that you need. If you make that your dwelling place. Because tafadhali, hauna right ya kwenda kwenye uulize, na kwa nini chakula mumeeka sijui nini? Ai, no. But if you're home, my mom knows. Ndio uliza kimami kwa nini sasa umeeka hoho kwa chakula? no, not just kulangi, because it's home for you. So he who dwells, he who makes the secret place of the Most High, you are home. That is why mtu kama Hezekiah angenda ulize Mungu, excuse me, I worshipped you, I served you, you have better had this years for me, I'm not going. Because it's home. It's home, you can say, you feel free, you're at home. You can say, no, Jesus, that was not our agreement. You know, he's your brother. Praise God. So we need to get a revelation of our circumstances. Don't give weight to circumstance. Begin to ask God to give you revelation, because no eye has seen, no ear has heard, nor has it entered the mind of man what God has in store for us. But he has revealed it to us through his spirit. You may not understand now, but you see, the more you dwell, the more you hear, the more you stay, the more you understand. Because apo Getsemane, najua walikuwa wanasemezana tu na God. And I think God kept reassuring him, you know what? You're not doing this alone. We got this. Praise God. So this thief who died out of the will of God, and this one that died in the will of God, the only difference was that one looked at circumstance and the other one looked at revelation. And again, the choice is ours. You choose whether to give weight to God, whether to give glory to God, whether to await the revelation of God, or to give weight to circumstance. Praise God. My last point. The element of faith. Praise God. Numbers 13:16. NIV, NLT, whichever. Okay, these are the names of the men Moses sent to scout out the land. Moses gave Hoshea, salvation son of Nun, a new name, Joshua, which means God saves. 17. When Moses sent them out to scout out Canaan, he said, go up through the Negev and then into the hill country. Look the land over, see what it is like, assess the people. Are they strong or weak? Are they few or many? Assess the people. Are they strong or weak? Are they few or many? Observe the land. Is it pleasant or harsh? Describe the towns where they live. Are they open camps or fortified with walls? And the soil. Is it fertile or barren? Are there forests? And try to bring back a sample of the produce that grows there. This is the season for the first ripe grapes. I think we'll stop there. This is the story of wametumwa, wanaambiwa assess. Praise God. Assess the land. Is it fertile? Kuna maji? Kuna hii? Yeah, you assess. Assess the fruit of that place. You see, walitumwa and they were given it was at their liberty to assess and then bring a report. And there were 12 of them. And 10 of them came. Wakiwa wamehoma. Eh? You know, but then Caleb and his BFF, they come and the first thing they say is, let us go, for we are able to conquer. Praise God. You see, book of 2 Corinthians 4 verse 16 to 18, it says that we look not at the things that are seen, but we look to those that are unseen. For the things that are seen are temporal, but those that are seen are permanent. Let us just say, look at your neighbor. Look at your neighbor now. And tell them, if you can see it, it is subject to change. If you can perceive it with the human senses, it is subject to change. You see, because the things that are seen are temporal, but the things that cannot be seen are permanent. That is why we walk by faith and not by sight. You see, these 10 guys, walipatiwa liberty. Go to that place, survey that land, and tell me, assess, and bring a report. Tell me what you see. si wote walienda na wako nao, kwani akina Caleb wako na watu wakubwa? Si they so? But why is it that 10 of them said, guy, hey, ko utoti gehota? And then these two, they're like, oh, I'm so excited. Let us go crush those people. And they saw the same thing. You see, there's power in what we say, in our spoken word. Our words are supernatural. As long as you can see something. You see, we are spiritual beings, not physical. We are spiritual beings in human bodies. So all our experiences ought to be spiritual. What we catch needs to be spiritual. So, tafadhali, that is why you look at a sick child and you say, I thank you, Jehovah God, because by your stripes, he is healed. How do you know he is healed and he's lying in a hospital bed in pipes? Because the things that are seen are temporal. And those that cannot be seen are permanent. So when you see disease, you don't even perceive it, don't respond to it. Speak the unseen, speak healing. When you're in a situation of brokenness, get into the presence of God and say, thank you, Jehovah God, because I know that you're my strength, my mighty warrior, my personal bravery, the victorious God of my salvation, no matter how weak, broken, or hurt you feel. Because the things that are seen are, but the things that cannot be seen are permanent. So if you can see it with your eyes, if you can hear it, if you can taste it, if you can feel it, it is subject to change. So let us not get weighed down on what we see, on what we feel, on what we hear. Because those things that we perceive humanly are temporal. If you feel weak, it is subject to change. If you feel discouraged, it is subject to change. If you see poverty, it is subject to change. If you feel, I'm not close to God nowadays. Akina jaribu kuomba Sister Nancy and it's not. Oh, if you can feel it, it is subject to change. Because the things that are seen are temporal. But those that cannot be seen are permanent. Hebrews 11:1, as I finish. Ha, nitamaliza mara moja. Okay, maybe mbili. Hebrews 11:1, message. The fundamental fact of existence. The fundamental fact of existence is that this trust in God, this faith, is the firm foundation under everything that makes life worth living. Oh, before we read that last statement, give me the Amplified 11:1. We will come back to that last statement. Now faith is, let's read this together. Now faith is the assurance, the confirmation of the things we hope for, being the proof of things we do not see and the conviction of their reality. Faith perceiving as real facts what is not revealed to the what? Praise God. Now faith is the one assurance. You cannot come and convince me that my name is not Susan, please. Ever since I was born, I've been called Susan. Nani atakuja ani convince otherwise? I am assured that is my name. And no matter how many names you give me, even if you were to make elections to choose a name for me, my name will remain Susan. Because I have an assurance. Number two, it is the confirmation. Sound room, please project for us. It's the confirmation. And it's, waliona mashaba, praise the Lord. Naona mungai huko. Ukiona title deed, will you lack sleep wondering somebody's going to come steal your land? You even sleep them more because you're like, let them disturb themselves ukonyuma when they come. Kwanza unaitwanga na swag. Because it's a title deed. Yani, unajua niyako, naniyako, and naniyako. Na hautakosa usingizi ukishanga kama mtu ataiiba. Kwa sababu hata wakihanga aje, they'll come back to point zero. Which is, I have the title deed. So this is what faith is to us. It's the assurance, the confirmation, and the title deed. Unapeangwa title deed of kitu hauna? So what does that tell you? That you already have it. Just because you cannot perceive it with the senses doesn't mean it's not there. Because the things that are seen are, but those that are not seen are permanent. So you know you have it. Please, you don't have to see it yet. You don't have to feel it yet. You don't have to hear it yet. You just need to connect to the supernatural. Because that is where we draw from. We don't draw from here. We draw from up there. Tafadhali ukitaka kudeal na issue iko hii level, please, you can't deal with earthly issues on an earthly level. For you to win, you have to go a level higher. Praise God. Kwa hivyo, if you want to win something at level one, the only thing you can beat it is if uko level two or three. So if you want to conquer here, we draw our strength from the spiritual realms. And that is why the weapons of our warfare are not flesh and blood. Praise God. And Hebrews 11:6 says that, Hebrews 11:6 in the NIV. And without faith, it is impossible to please God. Because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who honestly seek him. There's a better rendition says that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. It's impossible to please God without the assurance and the confirmation and the title deed. The message in 11:1 says that faith is our handle on the things that are unseen. Hivi nakwambia hata kama ujione unakwanga umeshikilia na faith. Praise God. And so 11:6 says that he is a rewarder of those that diligently seek him. The reward is not in the seeking, the reward is in the diligence. Praise God. The reward is not in the seeking. Kwa sababu neza msik leo na kesho ni choke. Neza msubiri leo na kesho ni choke. Praise God. So the reward is not in the diligence, in the seeking. The reward is in the diligence. You see, the reward is not giving yourself to God. The reward is in the giving yourself wholeheartedly to God. The reward is in the wholeheartedness. Praise God. The reward is not at it all knowing and trusting that you only believe what you can see. The reward is in the handle, faith. Knowing that I don't have to see it to believe it. I don't have to feel it to know it. Praise God. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, we honor you and we adore you for who you are. And we say thank you for speaking to us, Jehovah God. We say thank you, my God, for teaching us, King of all glory. And as we leave this place, God, I thank you because it is in the nature of seeds to grow. And I thank you for the seed that you have planted in our hearts, oh God, that we need to understand the element of identity, to understand the element of revelation, and to put into practice the element of faith. I thank you because your Holy Spirit is in the business of enabling each and every one of us, because he's our teacher, our advocate, he is our strength. And so we just call on your name and on your Holy Spirit, oh God, to continue enlightening us, Jehovah God, and teaching us, oh God. We love you and we adore you, oh God, for it is in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. We pray. God bless you.